evening.
Hi, Rick.
Welcome to the fourth in the PEN series, Foreign Exchange series. You're probably wondering why we're here, so I'll tell you a little story. I was in Europe this month for 2 weeks and doing some readings and so forth in Paris and Rome. And besides being asked a lot about what's going on in the country here, I was asked a lot about American publishing and about translation and how it's not happening here as much as it used to happen. In fact, I recently heard that of the 30,000 books published in the United States each year, less than 1% are translated from languages abroad. And PEN, recognizing that this is a serious issue for us, both just as a kind of literary deprivation, but also as a kind of political issue, has begun to try to create programming to help remediate the problem. And you're going to hear more from us on the subject in the coming year or so. But for the time being, the initial thrust of PEN's campaign to help promote translation is this reading series. This is the fourth, as you've heard, and we've had three very successful readings already, with the idea that we can just bring acclaimed American writers and great writers from abroad together to help all of us who love books and love literature to appreciate what's happening abroad. America has a very diverse and thriving national literature, but it's quite different from what's happening in countries abroad in many cases. So this gives us a great opportunity to begin to appreciate the riches of European and Asian and African fiction and literature. China, of course, is the most populous country on Earth, and we don't have many publications of Chinese novels and Chinese literature in this country at all. So it's a real blank spot for us. And this event, I think, is going to help bridge the differences a little bit. We've got the excellent Amy Tan and Ling Yan tonight. As most of you know, Amy Tan's most recent book is The Opposite of Fate. She's also the author of The Joy Luck Club, The Kitchen God's Wife, The 100 Secret Senses, The Bonesetter's Daughter, and two children's books, The Moon Lady and The Chinese Siamese Cat. Her essays and stories have appeared in numerous magazines and anthologies, and her work has been translated into more than 25 languages. Ling Yan was born in Shanghai and joined the People's Liberation Army as a dancer at age 12. In the late 70s, she began writing as a war correspondent and published her first novel in China in 1985. In the late 80s, she left China for the United States and studied creative writing at Columbia College, Chicago. Her story, Zuzu, the Sent Down Girl, was made into a film directed by Joan Chen. I believe you're going to see a little of it. And The Lost Daughter of Happiness, which I've recently been reading with great excitement, it's a really tremendous novel, is her first published work in English. You'll be able to buy copies after the reading and get them inscribed if you'd like. And I can't recommend it strongly enough. She's a book of stories also, but The Lost Daughter of Happiness is really a standout novel, and I recommend it strongly. We're going to have two dramatic readings from Ling's work by Mia Katigbak and B.D. Wong. They will read first, after which Amy and Ling will take their seats here on stage, and they'll speak for about an hour in a sort of flexible and freewheeling way. So I think it's going to be a great night. You're going to have a really good time. And here first to read is Mia Katigbak.
Slowly rising from the creaking bamboo bed, is you. The embroidery on your satin padded jacket must weigh 10 caddies. The parts stitched most densely are as hard as ice or armor. From a distance of 120 years, I'm amazed by the needlework, so thoroughly beyond me. Let me raise your chin a bit here and bring your lips into the dim light. That's it. Just right. Now I can see your whole face clearly. Don't worry. Others will just find exotic the face you consider too square. To the novelty seekers of your day, your every flaw is a distinction. Now turn around. Just like all those times in the auction block. You're used to the auction. That's where pretty whores like you come to know their worth. I found pictures of those auctions in some books about Chinatown. Dozens of female bodies totally naked, their beauty in sharp relief against the surrounding gloom. You're nothing like the other girls on auction. First of all, you live past 20. This is a miracle. I looked through all 160 of those books, and you were the only one to live so long. The other girls in your line of work started losing their hair at 18, their teeth at 19, and by 20, with their vacant eyes and decrepit faces, they were as good as dead, silent as dust. But you're nothing like them. Don't be so eager to show off your feet. I know they're less than 4 inches long, two mummified magnolia buds. I'll let you show them later. After all, you're not like that woman who lived at 129 Clay Street from 1890 to 1940 and made her living putting her 4-inch golden lotuses on display. Several thousand tourists a day would shuffle reverently past her door, looking at the way her dead toes had been broken clean under and now curled into the soles of her feet. Most of them came from the more genteel East Coast, though some even came from the other side of the Atlantic, just to pay homage to a vestige of antiquity on a real live body. In the deformity and decay of those feet, they could read, "The Orient." I know who you were, a 20-year-old prostitute, one of a succession of 3,000 prostitutes from China. When you stepped upon these golden shores, you were a fully grown woman. You had no skills, no seductive charms, not a trace of lust in your eyes. People could sense your distinctive simplicity the moment they met you. In an instant, you could make any man feel as if it were his wedding night. So, you were born a prostitute, a good-as-new bride. On a summer day in the late 1860s, there's a rather large girl standing in a barred window on a narrow lane in San Francisco Chinatown, and that's you. You have a strange name, Fusan. You're not from the Canton Delta, so your price is 30% higher than those girls with names like Pearl, Silky, or Snapper, who had a hard time proving themselves unsullied by foreign sailors on shore. Your 14-year-old colleagues instructed you to market yourself. If you don't get work for some, you won't get supper and you'll be whipped naked. Your juniors in the field considered you worthless. You didn't know how to sell yourself. You didn't know how to make eyes at the men outside the window. The histories describe this marketing in detail. Chinese prostitutes employ their own unique ways of attracting customers. "Nice Chinese girl. Hey, mister, come on in and see. Your daddy, he just go out. Two bitty looky, four bitty feely, six bitty dewy. Chinese girly, fresh off boat, good girly, only 30 cent. Every now and then, moved by such explicit language and cheap prices, someone would turn back, pause, and pick out one of those children, one much like the next. You didn't hawk yourself. Whenever a man looked at you, you smiled at him, hesitantly at first, and then so wholeheartedly you made him feel you were wild about him and perfectly content with your life. It was probably your smile that made this man realize you were no ordinary goods. Someone slows before your window. Bigger and taller than most, you rise from the creaky bamboo bed. The slight delay in your movements makes you seem almost dignified. People could forget for a moment that you were a caged prostitute for sale. This is what you were really like when you first arrived in San Francisco. I certainly won't let people confuse you with any of the other 3,000 whores from China.
Good evening. From The Death of the Lieutenant. when it was dark, the lieutenant was locked into an individual cell for criminals sentenced to death. His feet were shackled to the end of his cot. He sat there with no thoughts. After a while, he lifted his wrist to look at his watch, 10 o'clock at night. Out of habit, he began to wind his watch, but stopped after two turns. There was no need. It was going to stop anyway. After my life has stopped, it will still run for 10 or more hours before it finally stops as well. But it can be restarted, be readjusted, and begin its circling again. Each of its rotations was so effortless, so unlike human affairs. At that point, he heard the sound of a key in the lock outside, and then the sound of the iron bars opening. Presently, a fully armed guard and the woman from the courtroom walked in. Her eyes were very wide. He had no desire to know who she was or why she had come. From now on, no one could ever have any significance for him or do him any harm. The woman walked forward a few steps, adjusting her facial expression several times. She told the guard, "Please let me talk with him alone. Just a little while." The guard looked at that woman, apparently to see if she was entirely in her right mind. The lieutenant understood that the guard saw him as a wild beast. Even though it was tied up, such a beast could pose a threat for so slight a woman. The guard's expression was also worried because death had already started its process in the lieutenant. Toward a thing that has already embarked on dying, is already partially dead. Women are always half terrified and half disgusted. With these worries, the guard left the woman alone in the condemned prisoner's cell. The lieutenant stared straight ahead at the wall, feeling something clean, carrying an odor of cleanliness that gradually increased in the glaring bright light before his eyes. "I'd like to talk with you," she said. "I'm a writer. I write novels." "Who cares what you do? Why did you give up your right to appeal? It was your last chance. Maybe it could have turned the whole situation around," she said urgently. Little by little, he began to shake his head. His field of vision started to shake itself into muddy confusion. Her voice and speech were also shaken into confusion. She asked him what he was thinking at this moment. Injustice, remorse. He answered everything with this dull, exhausted shaking of the head. If he could have, he would have shaken off even this last bit of consciousness. He kept shaking his head, shaking until his death row cell was still as death, shaking until this woman, whose profession was to write about other people's pain and suffering, saw her hopes die and did not bother him with another word. He kept staring at the wall, waiting for her to leave. In the midst of his annoyed calm, he thought, a person's whole life is actually full of things like this that try one's patience. Finally, she said she was leaving. He should write that letter to his parents. "See you later. See you later." His face remained unsmiling. When he heard the gate close, he turned his face. "You." The lieutenant was amazed at his mouth suddenly coming unsealed. The woman writer turned back quickly from the cell door, her whole face and body nervous and agitated. "What do you want me to do for you? Don't miss this opportunity again. Maybe I can still do something in these last few hours." He looked at her, or more precisely, he looked at her hands moving and moving as she talked to him. The lieutenant was disoriented for a moment, knowing by her short breaths that she was waiting for his response. He was still shaking his head. "No, don't trouble yourself. You're worried that your mother, so weak and sick, won't be able to bear this news, aren't you?" Surprised, he stopped shaking his head. "She does read my thoughts," On his last home leave, his mother had supported herself on a cane while seeing him off. He kept saying, "Mother, go back." But his mother kept saying, "I'll see you off a little further, a little further." It was early morning, and the dark sky still revealed a thin sliver of moon. He hadn't wanted to disturb anyone with his leaving, but when he stealthily groped his way into the yard, Mother was already waiting, fully dressed, by the gate. Just before they arrived at the main road, he said, "Mom, once I've saved up some money, I'll bring you and Pa to Beijing to have a look." Mother seemed not to hear him. They walked on in silence for nearly half an hour. When he again pleaded with her not to go any further, Mother stopped in her tracks. She waited until she could breathe a little more easily, her eyes moving slowly from left to right, avoiding eye contact, and then she told him, "Never come back again. This time, go back to your army unit and live your own life from now on. Momo is no longer yours anyway. Don't let me worry you to death, drag you down to your death with this poor family. Look at this poor place. What do you want to come running back here for? A life lived is a life saved. Listen to your mother. Never come back here. This time, when you go, never in this life or in this world, come back here again." After she had finished, Mother went with him no further, nor did she watch him go off into the distance until she could no longer see him. Instead, she turned around and walked back, very slowly, but with great determination. If Mother knew he would really never return and knew the reason why, she wouldn't live long. They shouldn't have denied your request, the woman writer said. She was referring to the request he had had the most difficulty expressing to the court, the request that the officials conceal from his parents the fact that he had been executed. He had requested that they inform his folks only that he had died of foul play, or died violently even, but just not tell them he died because he broke the law. "Sometimes the law is as cruel as crime," the woman writer said. He turned his face back toward her and saw her neat figure set off by the lead-colored iron door. A dense feeling of loneliness welled up inside him. How far removed she was from crime. The door sounded with a metallic clang as it shut. When the clang of the opening door came again, he put down his pen. All through the night, he had used his uninjured left hand to fill the 4 sheets of paper he had been issued. He still had much to say, but he had no more time and no more paper left. The lieutenant watched the 2 guards walk in. He instinctively recoiled and at the same time thought how stupid this recoiling was. There's no point in resisting. He didn't say anything like, "Don't carry me, let me walk myself," because he had no confidence that he would be able to stand and walk. His legs were trembling severely. It was best just to let them tremble. He also knew he had that half-open mouth that so disgusted everyone. And there was a frozen string of saliva suspended between his upper and lower teeth, but he could no longer control this. 8 fully armed guards were waiting in front of the prisoner transport. Surprisingly, the woman rider was also there. Her mouth was pursed tightly, and she avoided looking in his direction. The guards stuffed him unceremoniously into the transport, dumping him onto the floor in the back. Then they sat down, one next to the other, on the 2 opposing benches inside. He faced the tail of the transport, kneeling between the 2 rows of feet. One of the soldiers stretched out a helping hand to the woman rider waiting outside. She leaned her body forward, but in the end, she didn't get in. "I'm not going to the execution grounds," she said. "You go ahead." For a moment, the lieutenant raised his head. She was looking at him, her eyes swollen with 2 large tears. The lieutenant couldn't be certain. He saw clearly that those were tears in her eyes, couldn't be certain what had caused them. Pity? Injustice? Perhaps those tears were just one life saying to another life, farewell. After a while, the lieutenant was taken out of the transport and plopped down shapelessly on a plot of muddy ground. He couldn't determine whether he was kneeling or sitting or if he was simply piled there. The transport and guards that had brought him left quickly after unloading him, and immediately a severe-looking military truck drove up, completely masked with canvas. An entire nest of soldiers jumped out, wearing military rain ponchos and rain hats, their mouths covered by large surgical masks, leaving only pairs of black eyes exposed. He understood. Every poncho hit one rifle. Behind his back, they relayed their orders in whispers. "It's still 5 minutes to four," a voice said. The lieutenant opened his eyes and used his last 5 minutes of life to look once more at the sky and the earth. It was a little point of pink between earth and sky. A little higher was the yellow morning star. Higher still, there was a thin sliver of moon, just like the one he saw when Mother said, "Don't come back." Then came a huge noise. The lieutenant did not feel this noise as coming from outside. Rather, it was a roar coming from inside his body. Along with the noise, he felt he had suddenly been magnified. Another sound came, and he saw the sky and the earth splattered with huge drops of blood. The lieutenant saw his own death, just as he saw the sky, earth, stars, and moon. So could he witness his own death, with blood spattered in all directions.
For doing that. I wanted to start off by telling you a little bit about my interest, why I'm so delighted to be here tonight doing this. About 4 years ago, I was in Australia at an international book festival, and an American book publisher came up to me and said, "What do you think are the most important things that we need to change in publishing?" And I thought about that, of the myriad things that could stand improvement, from royalty statements to publishing on acid-free paper. And then I realized what it was. I said, we need more books in translation. I had long been aware of this fact that there are so very few books, and that especially when I find that there are books that come out in translation in Chinese, I'm just so hungry to read them. But I've also believed for a long time that fiction is the portal to compassion. It is being in another person's consciousness. And to be in the translated writer's consciousness, it's both a very intimate one and yet a foreign one. And I think that we need to have this kind of immersion in imagination and this consciousness, so that we can become both better readers and better humanists. I have seen some glimmers of change recently. For example, Balzac and the Little Chinese Mistress by Da Shijie did land on the New York Times bestseller list and many other lists as well. It became a bestseller here as well as in France and won awards. But then I also remember that it came to our country in translation, but from the French. And I wondered if he had written that same book in Chinese to begin with and it came from China, if it would have had the same kind of reception, coming via France to the United States. Would it have received the same early success? Maybe it would have if it had won the Nobel Prize, which is exactly what happened to Gao Xingjian with Soul Mountain a few years ago. All this is to say that it is a very difficult road for Chinese writers to get their works translated and published here in this country. I think some of the reasons are very simple. There's a basic fact that it's hard to pronounce certain names in Chinese, especially when they have those C's and Q's and X's and you don't know what to do with those. And there might also be some cultural references that we're not familiar with. For example, in White Snake, the title of this collection of stories refers to a story, a myth, an opera that is very well known in China, as common as Our Sleeping Beauty. And yet here it would require, as the translator Larry Walker did, some kind of explanation in the beginning about what that means so that you can more fully appreciate the imagery in the story. I was telling Gali by happy coincidence that a month ago I actually had the chance to go to both Chengdu, which is where Gali lived during part of her time in China, and I got to see the opera, a version of the opera of White Snake. So I told her that I had very carefully done my research to come here. I think also that what I want to explore with Belling are not just these differences in ideas, but also differences perhaps in literary traditions. We expect as readers a certain kind of story or literary conventions. And some of these may be a little different in, say, a story written by a Chinese writer. And we also have to wonder, what is it about these stories that are absolutely unique to the particular writer we're reading? That, you know, we can't see the whole encapsulation of a literature in one single writer, and yet that's often what we do. We interpret that to represent all of a literature. There is another personal reason why I'm very excited to be talking to Gulling on stage, and that is that I, as an American writer, often wonder what I would have written had I been born in China. I do have three sisters who were born in China, and they said that their imaginations at a very early age had become rusted. I wonder if I had gone on to be a writer during a childhood in the Cultural Revolution, would I still be writing about difficult relationships with mothers or daughters? Or would I have found that secondary to the complexities of merely surviving famine and degradation and persecution? So for all these very personal reasons, I'm very delighted to be on stage tonight with Gulling talking about her work. I am riveted by her work. Her fiction has qualities that I love in any writer. Foremost, there's the language and the imagery, and you had a chance to hear some of that tonight. There's also the kind of truths that she writes about. She's written incredible fiction I'm very excited about because it has a kind of sharp irony that and visceral imagery that I don't find in other works. It also has sensuality and complexity and literary innovation. The stories are not always easy to read. They don't provide any pat answers. They're not neatly compartmentalized views on Chineseness or Chinese or culture or America, but or history or romanticism. In fact, I find that the stories almost have an anti-romantic quality to them in looking at romanticism as an illusion, perhaps, and yet very, very essential to survival. So tonight we're going to get to know Gulling better, to delve into the workings of her consciousness, her imagination,
and her passion
as a writer. And we'll be discussing, in a conversational style, I hope, her process of writing, the nature of her literary themes, cultural themes, translation issues, the current atmosphere of literature in China, American appetites for world literature, and the making of the movie Shu Shu, The Sent Down Girl, for which Gulling wrote the screenplay. And we will be showing a clip of that movie in a little bit. I want to start off with your early life in China by reading to the audience a short passage from the story White Snake. And Let me first describe the story. It concerns a famous dancer, Sun, who was in prison during the revolution for sexual and political misconduct. And she's humbled and tormented and really made to descend into the bowels of human degradation. And along comes love, or something like it, a strange, unequal, and forbidden love. And she begins to shed her decrepit skin and emerge once again as the famous dancer, only to discover love is an illusion. Now here's how Yengeling describes this dancer at her low point. Less than 6 months of being locked up in the performing art troupe scenery warehouse, and she looked exactly like any middle-aged woman you'd see on the street. A keg-shaped waist, gourd-like breasts, and big squarish buttocks that spread out so wide you could lay out a whole meal on them. Her face was still pretty, only broader, and her eyelashes would still sweep back and forth until you felt your heart tickle. But the black and white of her eyes were starting to lose their clarity. Now, readers often assume that what we write is often autobiography, thinly described as fiction, and we do have autobiographical echoes, but in reading that passage, we can see that not everything is autobiographical in Galene's fiction, because she, as you can see, does not have a keg-shaped waist. She does not have these other declining attributes, but she was a dancer, recruited at age 12. And I find it interesting that so many Chinese writers that have been translated have had some sort of an artistic background at some point in their lives. An Chi Min was recruited to be an actress, and Li Chunqin, who wrote Mao's Last Dancer, was also a ballet star. And I'm thinking that maybe there were opportunities for most of the youth of those days to express themselves artistically. So I wanted to find out if there was any influence in your being a dancer that had impact in your fiction?
I think my being a dancer was totally accidental, and I was not so good.
Well, you were recruited, but...
I was recruited, and that was the one way of survival.
Uh-huh.
And to survive, the kids going to countryside.
Mm-hmm.
And I know my brother was going, and...
to the countryside.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And the policy back then was one family can save one kid. So we have two. He was going. But if I leave for the army, he can be saved. So that was our family's policy.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So you became a dancer, and what did you perform? Were you performing things in honor of the party or the army, the Red Army?
Of course. Yeah, back then everything was honoring Mao Zedong and the army and the relation between people, Chinese people and army.
And how did your family stand during that time in the Cultural Revolution? Your father was a writer, and your mother was an actress, and so these were perhaps occupations that were they looked upon as bourgeois or as bad elements during that time?
Yeah, my father was condemned and was sent to countryside to toil, and my mother was with us. And my grandmother was with us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was very hard. My father's salary stopped.
Mm-hmm. And you grew up in Shanghai, was it, or in Chengdu?
I was born in Shanghai and brought up in Anhui province,
mm-hmm.
and went to Chengdu to join the army.
Okay. Chengdu, by the way, for those who are not familiar with Chinese geography, is in a part of China that is also known as the stepping stone to the Himalayas, to Tibet. It's in Sichuan province, over on the west side. And it, sort of cosmopolitan-wise, I would equate it to perhaps our Cleveland, in terms of, big city, a lot of business, but not quite as with it as, say, New York.
The food is good, though.
The food is good, yes. Sichuan peppers, you can eat this, you know, the origin of the Sichuan tofu dish.
Yes.
And the peppers are quite different. They can paralyze your gut, as it did to me one time. So at some point, you also became a war correspondent. How were you selected for that? Did they somehow see that you had writing skills and that you would make an ideal writer?
In the late part of my dancing career, I started to, I was sent to learn to a dancing school to learn choreography. So, and in order to do the job, I need to make a synopsis. And sometimes, you know, in China, the dance has all the dramatic elements, you know. Mm-hmm. Then if you cannot explain it with movements, you have to sing, you know, Latin songs, and you have to write lyrics. So then I realized I could write. And when the Vietnamese and Chinese had a border conflict, and so I thought I was bored with the dancing, and I, you know, they lacked, because the war broke out so suddenly, and they lacked war correspondents. Mm-hmm. And I was the only woman, and I was very curious about the war. And
where did they send you? Where you?
They sent me to the field hospital,
uh-huh.
Yeah, where I interviewed a lot of the wounded soldiers.
I see.
Yeah.
So, and then did you feel very committed to the vision that the youth had during that time of the Cultural Revolution? Was that just something ingrained, or had you already been starting to question what that was about?
Oh, I always hated Cultural Revolution because my father was tortured. And I hated it secretly because all the kids in our dancing troupe were from different families. Mm. And so I knew I was kind of an enemy in that mm-hmm. group, but I didn't dare to express anything. And so when I went to the front, and after I talked to some soldiers, I realized that the war was wrong. Just mm-hmm. like now, I realized that the war was wrong, is wrong.
Now, what year was this, the years that you were this war correspondent?
It's 1979.
Mm-hmm. A lot of your stories, well, the ones that we are able to read in English, have to do with a kind of, they have to do with the Cultural Revolution often, or they have to do with also a kind of love that gets distorted with suffering and sacrifice and almost a kind of hopelessness, and then a surprise in which you find that love or romanticism is not what you think it is. And I was wondering, were your early works, your early books, also drawn to these same ideas? Or am I encapsulating your stories correctly? That's another thing, is that we may be interpreting what your intentions are as a writer quite differently, reading them from American eyes.
I think I am unaware of my own works. And in the early part of my writing, there is a certain romantic elements in that, but I derided it most of time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, like a lot of us who are writers, sort of, you write what's there, but you're not analyzing what you're writing at the time. So,
that's right.
And some of your work has been banned in China. I know the film Shosho, the Sent Down Girl, was banned for sexual and political reasons, and I heard that some of your books were also banned for other reasons. Is that right? And can you tell us a little bit about some of the reasons for that?
No, actually, my books are doing pretty well.
Good.
even Shosho Sent Down Girl, this story, this short story, which the movie is based on, was published in China okay.
Oh, okay.
They didn't. Uh-huh. They didn't say much. They have trouble with some short stories, but they just didn't publish. They did uh-huh. not stand. Publication in China, in the publishing business in China, is much open, mm-hmm. and much open than movie business.
Mm-hmm.
And
was it always open in the 80s as well, or it's much more open in many different areas of life? China's much
yeah,
more
it open. Depends. You know, it depends on who is the head of propaganda ministry. And it depends on the political situation and the economic situation. It all depends. And mm-hmm. sometimes they feel they give you too much freedom, they want to, you know, take it back.
Mm-hmm.
And if some writers reach too deep into people, and they think it's, you know, it all depends. But now mm-hmm. it's much better.
Mm-hmm. Now that you do have a Western audience, I was wondering if you ever think as you're writing whether some of those ideas might be difficult for a Western reader to understand. Does it ever cross your mind, or, you know, as you're writing?
It crossed my mind, but I can't help it. I just have to write what I really feel like writing,
mm-hmm.
and those stories that keep haunting me, and they mature, they want to be born, so that's it.
Do you have certain ideas or intentions when you write? You want to say, I just want to write a really good story that somebody's going to enjoy, or do you say to yourself, I want to write a story that explores the idea of love, or I'm just curious, what are your reasons for writing? What is it that's boiling up inside of you that has to get out?
One reason is I grew up during the Cultural Revolution. And that's the time when all human nature came to play. You know,
mm-hmm.
that was a big stage of 10 years for me to see all kinds of characters, unexpected, you know, characters without masks, and they play wild.
Mm-hmm.
So I collected so many stories. I heard stories. I saw stories. You know, it's stories, all just subconsciously stored away in my memory. And when I became a writer, and it started to come alive,
mm-hmm.
and I also feel like, you know, Chinese is a people who is very forgetful, you know, the bad things are kept happening to them, still happen to them. They don't remember anything. They forgave, you know, those people who, you know, put the suffering over them.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I got to be the only one who remembers things.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember them. Sometimes I think of writing a story, and I heard a story that immediately that makes me passionate, want to write. But I don't trust my instant feeling. I'll let it cool down, and I see if it keeps haunting me.
Mm.
It's like the story, the Shoshu, the Sandown Girl. I heard it maybe 20 some years ago, and then it kept coming back to me. And I kept asking myself, you know, what's the meaning behind it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so then I started writing it. And without creating this Tibetan hurt man, the story is very dark and ugly,
mm-hmm.
very ugly. So I have no desire to write it.
In the original story, was the girl also sent from Chengdu to the Tibetan area, or
She was sent to the countryside. The countryside. Uh-huh. But I've never been to the countryside. So I only went to Tibet. So mm-hmm. I know Tibetan people very well. Mm-hmm. And so I moved the story to Tibetan area.
And the ending and the real story was not quite as the same as the one that is.
No.
I remember our talking about this. I was so fascinated to find out what had happened. By the way, I should mention, Gulling and I have actually known each other for a number of years. We first met at a Thanksgiving at my house. And we have a mutual friend, Joan Chen, who was also the director of the movie Shosha. You also came to the United States in 1989, a very significant year. Can you tell me a little bit about that time?
Oh, that was my, I think that was my the last straw falling, you know. It's the complete disillusion with communism after they shot the students on Tiananmen Square. I was totally disappointed. Totally disgusted with this government, but I'm disgusted with this country as well now. Probably too idealistic, and I try to. At that time, America seemed to be such a free land, you know, for a free thinker like myself, you know. It tolerates all kinds of people. And now I don't know which country I'm going to go next. I just naturalized. The irony is, I just got myself naturalized.
And tell them where you're living.
Yeah, then I cannot turn back, you know. I lost my citizenship of China.
Well, she's now living in Nigeria.
Yes. Then I decided to leave China for good. It was so bad. The situation was so bad. I was in graduate school for writers, young writers. So
in the United States.
No, back,
oh,
in China.
Back in China. Uh-huh.
So whole time we stopped all the classes. So all we did was say, what time, do you have a lullaby, what time and what day you're where, mm-hmm. just stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, that was going to go on for 1 year to betray each other, and I left.
When you came to the United States, you went to Columbia University in Chicago and to study creative writing. What was that experience like? Did you find that the notions about writing were different, or simply melded right in with what you were doing, only in a different, being discussed in a different language?
I never thought it could be taught. And in this country, I learned that everything can be taught. I benefited by it a lot, and because if I want to make a translation, in the story from a different point of view, and I have to. Sometimes it was difficulty. And now, I have some skill, have some technique that I learned from these classes. It's sometimes easier, mm-hmm. yeah. Mm-hmm. And more conscious of writing, mm-hmm. yeah.
Do you ever discuss any of these ideas you have for stories with your husband?
Yes, sometimes I would tell him, but he's very encouraging. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I don't trust his words.
And when you talk about this, are you discussing this in Chinese or in English?
Both. Uh-huh. Our conversation is so funny that you know it's mixed with two languages. You know, I think some are more vivid in Chinese and some.
The arguments are in what language?
I use my language and he uses his. If I use English, if you would stop and correct my English.
with the novel, The Lost Daughter of Happiness, which, by the way, is set in San Francisco, and this daughter of happiness phrase translates into prostitute. It was a common term used for prostitutes back then. But you set the story in San Francisco, so it's different from your other, well, you had a story set in Australia as well, but this one is set in the past. And it's the story of a prostitute and a young boy. I was rather surprised reading the description of it on the back, because I ended up thinking, this led me to think it was going to be some kind of romance with, I don't know, a lot of kissing and things like that with an 11-year-old boy, and it was quite a different story for me, in contrast to what I read here. This is a woman who almost seems without a mind of her own. She's very passive. She almost seems without emotion, and yet she's the ultimate Zen survivor. She's able to give this little smile as all these terrible things are happening around her. And I wanted you to talk a little bit about a number of things with that book. First of all, what kind of research did you have to do, and where did you find all this information? Who did you use as models for the prostitute, Fusang?
I made her up. But my first inspiration was from that picture. Remember the picture?
Right, that was such a...
Yeah.
I'm sorry that they didn't have that on this book so I could show you. There's a very famous picture of a prostitute walking through the streets, and her head is bowed, and you see her very shiny hair, and she has on a very vivid, it looks like it's a black and white photo, but her costume has very striking designs on it, and she seems to be looking down, because at the time you were not supposed to look up at proper society.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, then I went, when I saw the picture in Chinese, some kind of a San Francisco History Society or something, it's a little museum and you need to walk down, and it's like a basement, and it was a huge picture of her. And I was immediately, struck by the image, and I thought it must be some story behind this woman. So I started researching about this woman, and I didn't find anything about her. But in the course of research, I found a lot of stories about Chinese prostitutes and early Chinese immigrants. And about the injustice that Chinese people suffer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There is also something in the story about the missionaries, the two women who saved the slave girls, and that was something that did actually happen in San Francisco. A very famous woman named Donaldina Cameron, who would rescue these women and young girls from the cribs. But the view here in the story is perhaps a little different from that we might read in American history, that the people who save the girls are put the girls in another kind of prison of sorts, a prison of the mind, where they're being told to change and to do certain things and not do certain things. And it was one of the things that was fascinating to me to read about this. This was clearly not an American story about America, because it had that different take on so many aspects of it. Tell me also about your choice of the young boy, an 11-year-old boy with a sexual fantasy with a prostitute, and it carries on really till the end of his life, Why did you choose an 11-year-old boy?
And I read this paragraph about a young boy from 8 to 14 going to visit Chinese prostitutes regularly, you know, using their candy money and lunch money. So that was the statistics taken back in 70s, mm-hmm. 1870s. Mm-hmm. So I was so shocked. And why Chinese women? And I couldn't figure out why Chinese women, and either they're cheaper, right? And maybe just the young boy can buy them with only candy money, or they are too exotic. And or they have some motherly quality in them, mm-hmm. or something, you know, that attracted these almost 2,000 young boys mm-hmm. to these Chinese women. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh, this is a great party between them, you know. So I started to write about one of these boys and with one of these girls. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It struck me at a certain point that the boy, being 11 years old and growing into his teens, was a perfect metaphor also for the kind of innocence and the kind of beliefs about this Chinese woman, that, and he would save her, and yet at the same time he had a terrible hatred of Chinese people. He wanted to destroy Chinese people because that was the way he could save her. And as I was reading this, I was thinking of so many people who have a similar take, that they want to save a certain part of a population, and yet they have a great deal of hatred for the rest of that society that created them. Was that a theme that you wanted to have, or an idea that you were exploring in the story?
Yes, I think it, when I yes, when I set it out, you see, I didn't have too much a story to tell. All I had was the idea. So this story was based on all my ideas. You know, I realized how much American, you know, white want to save all kinds of people, or not white. And the Christian wanted to save all who are not Christian. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Why do these people want to save other people? All the time she tries to tell Chris, this young boy, don't save me, mm-hmm. just love me. Mm-hmm. You know, but in the end, he didn't get her. Mm-hmm. You know, she mm-hmm. he doesn't get her. That's why.
Don't give away the ending.
No, she loves him so much, right. But she cannot take him as a, you know, all the time she cannot be sure if he wants to save her or to love her, you know.
Right, and that he loves her, especially when she wears certain clothing. Mm-hmm. But when she looks proper and she's wearing the white sackcloth, you know, and she's been rescued by the missionary, she sort of has lost her allure, her Chineseness, and some quality that he liked. As he gets older, when he is... I think it's 18 or so, he does seem to lose some of that quality of innocence and almost feels he can be away from the kind of romantic love he had for this infatuation. But then he seems to be drawn to it, almost like a sexual fetish more in that way. One of the things that I wondered about is, as I'm talking about your fiction, does most of it ring true to you as in terms of what you thought you were writing, or are we reading it differently? I'm always fascinated when people explain to me what they got out of my book. I really loved it that you explained about Chinese culture, and that wasn't my intention at all. And so when you hear people talking about your books, or you read these blurbs on the back of what you're trying to do, that you're trying to write history, or you're trying to show differences in culture. Do you find that rings true to you, or is it a strange idea?
Hmm. This is too long a question.
Okay. Do you find, oh yes, I said I was going to ask the straightforward question at the end. Do we interpret your stories correctly? Do we read the stories the way you think the story
should be read? I think a good story should be very ambiguous. And people can read from, you know, the beginning, whatever they want to read. And I think that's the best way and a writer can expect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And there's a saying, a Chinese saying, different people will take a different thing and understood the different thing from the same story.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So.
I've always felt that too. That you know, it's that each story is a different story in the hands of a different reader.
Mm-hmm.
That they make the story what it is as well. There's a very powerful. I'm not sure if I can find it. A very powerful paragraph here. And I just want to see if I can, yes, right here. Anger, it's about anger and hatred. And this is following a riot in which a number of people are killed and wounded and a big fight over that somehow involves Fusang. Anger can turn to hatred just like that. Hatred is amazing. It makes people self-righteous. It drives them with a sense of mission. I'm not talking about revenge. That's too simple. People are born with a higher form of hatred, so immense it doesn't even need a target. Like love so vast, no object is necessary. This kind of hatred can lie dormant for years, like a swell of darkness, and people are never even conscious of it. But once the darkness is breached, all rationality drowns, and the things people do out of hatred serve only the purpose of fulfilling an overwhelming emotional need. Burning, smashing, killing, rape, they're all just channels. It doesn't even matter what started it, because people quickly become intoxicated by the sheer spectacle of destruction. Like love at the earth-shattering stage, hatred, by this point, feeds on itself simply for its own sake. The pleasure of watching some person or thing destroyed by one's own hand is virtually orgasmic. These are the kind of ideas that that are in this book, and I was just, to me, that particular passage covered so much about things that you must have seen during the Cultural Revolution, as well as reading about history. And I wondered if you wanted to talk more about, this idea of hatred that you've seen. You see it in a number of your stories, aspects, where you've talked about this.
Yeah, I've seen enough during different political campaigns in China. It's just the hatred turned immediately or very quickly into something completely abstract. It amazes me. I don't hate many people. I don't hate people. I don't think they're worth it. I think, you know, the greatest you know, maybe I know I hate who, you know. I hate Mao Zedong, you know, because he is powerful enough to take my hatred. Not other people or things that I don't really, I sometimes I think I'm frustrated or disgusted, but when I look at these people back in during the Cultural Revolution, when I was very little, you know, I saw people killing each other, beating each other up. And I was very just lost and amazed, and I'm still having these pictures running in my mind. You know, why, you know, all of a sudden between them two, there's nothing between them two that needs to be, you know, hated.
Right. It's not personal. It's anonymity of hatred. That's so frightening.
Just like people need to love. Mm-hmm. You know, they need to worship, they need to love, they need to hate. And that's just some kind of, I don't know, I'm still, by examining it, I'm still trying to understand. Mm-hmm. And it's still going on, you see.
Yes, it resonated so much also with things that were going on in Iraq. So,
yeah.
It was a very powerful paragraph.
Then it's going out of control so fast, and mm-hmm. you know, the things happen in the prison. And I think do all these guards know what they're doing? You know? Very soon things are just out of control. Mm-hmm.
Is it difficult for you to write about these things in Chinese and then see them translated into English? Obviously, you speak and read enough English that you can see your translation and see what's been done with it. Do you feel that it captures the same qualities or intensity of what you were feeling when you wrote that down?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, you have the added advantage that you were sleeping with your translator. So you could both really, you know, work this out.
Actually, I never helped him. Uh-huh. Sometimes he needs to look up a words in dictionary and just tell me just the pronunciation. I said, you work that out yourself. I have a new story to create. Once the story is completed, I just don't want to touch it. I don't want to read it.
Gillian's translator, by the way, for the collection is her husband, Larry Walker. Who speaks actually many languages fluently. I was also wondering, did you get in a lot of fights? I mean, I can't imagine working with your husband on any kind of literary project. And I love my husband doing it, but I cannot imagine, having him sort of translate my work for me. Was that a difficult experience, or? You just let him do his thing and you do your thing.
Oh, he did it completely on his own. And in the end, I read this book. When I first read the Galley Proof, I said, whoa, this is pretty good. When I read The White Snake, I said, oh, this story is touching. I hadn't read the story for so long, you know, I forgot it. Uh-huh. And when he refreshed it. Uh-huh. And in different language, I had different perspective, and the expressions are fresh to me. So it's fun.
Yeah. You know, I do have to say also, when I started to read the stories in White Snake, the first page I got to, I thought, oh, the language is so stilted. I wonder if this is a problem with the translation. And then it wasn't until later that I realized that this was the official story. And it's read, it's a letter, actually, that that they have written, respected and beloved premier. So it's really an ironic thing. It's that it has that kind of formal, stiff language of the letter being written to the party leaders by them. And then the tone of it just changed completely when it got to the popular account and then, you know, the other accounts. So it's sort of a Rashomon of what has happened to this woman. Going on. But I also say that to you in case some of you start off reading and saying, what is this beloved and dear premier? You know, that that is one of the wonderful qualities also of you take these things, they always seem very innovative, very new and fresh to go from one convention to another to talking to the audience, to saying, as though, or talking to the character the way that you do in here. You say, you know, turn around, look up, let me see, you know, and it's a one-sided conversation that you have. I think this is a cue that I'm supposed to do the movie now. And if so, let's do a transition then. Some incredible scenes in this movie of both the countryside and then very difficult scenes of this young girl allowing herself to be ravaged by strangers repeatedly in hopes that one of them will be her ticket to escape this area, this job that she's been assigned to. But I chose this scene because it was the kind of imagery that must have been what you lived with, the kind of movies, and when I saw that woman singing the songs, and I thought, well, that could have been you dancing to that same scene, and I thought, what a contrast as well, that we were all watching, say, John Wayne and singing Home on the Range together, and then what you see is the contrast there of everybody watching their version of the war hero. But tell me a little bit about the putting together of that movie. You created a story within a story that wasn't in the original. You had the girl start off in Chengdu, but I found that the imagery that was in the story and in the movie was very similar in a way.
And I was very happy that Joe made it.
Well, I recommend that you both read the story and then watch the movie, and you can also see what Galing did in making this a more complete story for the film, with a backstory of what the life this girl came from. I'd like to end our discussion session now and open up to the audience for some questions. So if we can have the lights up and then raise your hand if you want to ask a question. Yes. How did you find an American publisher?
Me?
Okay. Was very to me was somehow Will Schwab, my publisher, and I got introduced by our film, the publicist for the film, and so then he started reading my book, The Lost Daughter of Happiness, and so he pretty soon he had a contract on the table, and then I told him I have a thing. So that was it. We found each other.
So the movie then helped to get your fiction recognized and then to
find a publisher. Yes,
so it was
the
really
thing, yeah.
Very much related to that.
Yeah. Sometimes making movie is pain, but then you think then you save yourself from all these publicities and you don't have to travel to read to maybe three people. And the movie will do all the things that the publicity do. Yes.
Do you believe you understand any more now about Americans' urge to save anybody? Save everybody?
Let me repeat the question in case people didn't hear that. Do you believe that you now understand more about America's urge to save
individuals
in the world?
No, not completely. Because, when I see the situation getting worse and I become more and more confused. There were a lot of things for you to save in at home,
Yes.
Can you speak a little bit more about the translation? Like the translation is true to a Chinese sensibility or to your original sensibility?
She asked if the translation feels true to a Chinese sensibility.
80%, I would say. And some people told me, my readers who read both Chinese and English, that my language is more masculine in Chinese, especially for Fu Sang. After it's been translated, it's become very feminine. Yeah. And Larry, my husband, translated the first book. And Larry is the person who doesn't cut any corners, every corner it turned out. It's meaning is all there, but his problem is the rhythm, the breath, it's not there. I'm very satisfied with their translation, but authors are all very narcissistic. No translation is 100% to their satisfaction. That's the problem.
Yes.
Could you tell me writers who influenced you or who you admire?
Writers who influenced you or who you admire?
It depends. Depends on what age I am. When I was young, I was influenced by a French writer called Romain Rolland, and a lot of French writers, and also Chinese writer Cao Xueqing, who wrote Red Chamber, Dream of Red Chamber. And I'm influenced by Garcia Marquez, by Flannery O'Connor, and Sorbello, too many of them. Yes.
When did you begin to be interested in the English language?
First up, when I was invited by the U.S. Information Agency to come to this country in 88 to pay a visit to the young writers in Iowa. And I was, I didn't speak a word English, so I saw how they discussed their words. And I thought that if I could speak their language, I could hear their discussion about their literary works. And after that, I started to learn English. So my English actually only 15 years old.
Wow.
Pretty young.
Yes. Hearing is going. You said you left China in 1989. You were discussed a dissolution, and it's been 15 years, actually almost 15 years and 3 days since those events in the square. Things have changed, and did you? The last part I didn't quite hear.
I think they're politically they're more open-minded, but I think they're more interested in corruption. Now their focus is on economy. The economy did improve a lot after Tiananmen Square, after I left China. I would give them credit for some political reform.
I think that one went up faster. So.
I try to write for all kinds of people, and I think that there is a deep down we are all the same. And, did I answer your question? Yes, I'm trying. Sometimes I find it difficult writing for everybody to understand. But I think after, if this person is intensely interested in what I'm talking about, then you will understand.
One more question. Yes.
No, writers in China. And they were supposed to teach us how to, just like at Columbia College, how to teach us how to work things better, or write better, or guide us to read certain books. But you know, after the chemistry happened, the event happened, we all had to sit down to do political criticism, in which we have to say this person was missing in the class, and I suspect that he maybe went to the square. And that person has to say, I was with such and such person, and who can prove I didn't go. So all these sessions are become political criticism, which they call and so-called. Basically, they encourage the students to betray each other.
I want to thank our readers and Rick Moody and Gulling and all of you for joining us this evening.